Today, I'm Katie Hawks, and today my web talk will be about Che Guevara. But more specifically, it will be about Che Guevara's image and the legacy of that image. He was the world symbol of the possibilities of one man. Frantz Fanon, the author of The Wretched of the Earth, the landmark novel condemning European imperialism in Africa, said this about one of his contemporaries. That contemporary was Ernesto Che Guevara. It is likely that the name Che is familiar to you. You may know a bit about his background. You may have heard about the circumstances of his death. But it is most likely that you have seen Che more than you have heard of him. His image, frozen in time through a single photograph, has become a symbol of revolution, leftism, and liberation. His image is one of the most reproduced in the world. He has become legendary. But is that legend one that Che would be proud of if he were alive today? To know whether or not Che would approve of his posthumous image, we first must know the values he held in life. Ernesto Guevara was born to an upper middle class Argentinian family in 1928. He was asthmatic as a child and continually suffered from asthma attacks as an adult. He studied medicine for several years before famously traveling around South America on a motorcycle with his cousin. On that trip, Che saw the suffering of the poor for the first time. He began to believe that the ruling capitalist system was unjust and cruel. He said, "I knew that when the great guiding spirit cleaves humanity into two antagonistic halves, I would be with the people." Che traveled Latin America, earning his medical degree and continuing to write, and eventually traveled to Cuba, where amongst communist revolutionaries. There, he and Fidel Castro would become famous for a successful coup against Batista and capitalism, and for installing the first communist government in the Western Hemisphere. Che became an integral part of the Cuban government under Castro, but eventually decided to travel to other poor countries in the hope of inciting a successful revolution and installing a communist government there. Che was killed by the American Central Intelligence Agency in Bolivia in 1967 during a covert mission. His hands were cut off for identification, and his body was buried in an unmarked grave. The CIA feared him becoming a martyr. However, the mysterious circumstances surrounding Che's death only heightened his legend, a reputation that he was gaining before his murder. While Che's image, if not his ideas, spread rapidly after his death, he was already something of a legend in life. Many famous revolutionaries, writers, politicians, and more described him with awe. Jean-Paul Sartre said that he was the most complete man of his age. He lived his words, spoke his own actions, and his story and the story of the world went parallel. Not only was his personality praised, but also his looks. I.F. Stone, a radical American journalist, said that the word that first came to mind on meeting Che Guevara was simplicity. He was the first man I had ever met whom I thought not just handsome, but beautiful. Not everyone was a fan of Che's, particularly capitalist countries. The United States in particular hated Che, and that hatred still lingers today. Journalist Paul Valle said, "It is not difficult to deconstruct the power of the man and his myth. He was sultry and sexy. There is no myth around his revolutionary comrade Fidel Castro, who also made the mistake of staying alive." Che Guevara, by contrast, died young, as all the heroes of the age, from James Dean to Jimi Hendrix, did and should. Despite this lingering US resentment, Che's photogenic face, coupled with his fierce nature, made him a legend during life. But that reputation grew and morphed after his death into something greater than himself. Che's image has been used as a weapon, a tool against injustice and tyranny for decades. His image has proliferated around the world and has been used in support of hundreds of causes. However, it is not just Che that inspires so many. It is one image in particular, altered over time for various purposes. The image was taken by a photographer named Alberto Korda. Alberto Korda was a fashion photographer in Cuba and took thousands of photos of Che during the 1960s. However, there was one in particular that stuck. It was taken at a funeral Che was attending. He is wearing a beret with a full beard and a solemn, fierce stare. Korda took the image in half a second, among hundreds of others he had taken that day. He called it Guerrero Heroico and described Che's expression as pissed off and pained. After cropping, it became Korda's favorite, so much so that he began to give the photo away for free to whoever asked. Korda didn't copyright the image for decades, partly because Che's friend Fidel Castro banned the possession of intellectual property in Cuba, but The other reason was that the image was spread around the world because it was free. And after a graphic designer had the shading removed into a very clean and easily reproduced stencil, Che's fate as a symbol was set. This easily accessible image of Che has been reimagined in hundreds of times and hundreds of ways. Che has been natures, he has been countries, he has been John Lennon, he has been stenciled and Warholed and muraled. He has been men, women, soldiers, and even Jesus Christ himself. The comparison of Che with Jesus is the most prominent theme in his reproduced image. He is often a Christ-like figure in posters, seeing as many Latin Americans believe that he was murdered while trying to aid them. He is worshipped as a saint in Bolivia. This is highly ironic, however, because Che himself denied his likeness to Jesus during life, saying, "I am no Christ, nor a philanthropist. I'm the very opposite of Christ. I will fight with all the arms within reach instead of letting myself get nailed to a cross." Despite this, Che's image remains connected with Jesus. According to the Center for the Study of Political Graphics, Jesus is the most recognized figure in the world, and Che is second. The propagation of Che's image was not all done in the name of leftist revolution. Often, his image was exploited by those looking to earn profit or merely gain attention. His image has been used to sell everything, from ice cream to cigarettes. Alberto Korda actually only copyrighted the image when he got wind that Smirnoff was using it to sell vodka. Che was a virulent opponent of capitalism and would loathe that his image was being used to manipulate the poor and benefit the wealthy. Journalist Sean O'Hagan said, "Today, Che lives, all right, but not in the way he or his fellow revolutionaries could have ever have imagined in their worst nightmares. He has become a global brand." Guevara would have hated being mass-produced more than anything in the world. It truly would be his worst nightmare. Che also would dislike the fact that so many people who bear his face, whether it be on a poster, on a t-shirt, or any other medium, have no idea who he was or what he fought for. A young UCLA student thought Che was a musician, while a cyclist at Venice Beach identified him as the guy who invented those mojitos. By spreading Che's image far and wide, his vision and impact have been diluted by repeated exposure. He is not as revolutionary as he once was. Having a poster of Che up in your dorm room no longer means that you're a dedicated communist or revolutionary theorist or know anything about him at all. Many people are using Che's image for entertainment without knowing his true significance. This, I think, would have devastated him more than anything. To know that his life's work had been reduced to a cheap t-shirt would crush anyone, but it would hit Che especially hard, because he was a man of action, a man who hated having his photo taken because there was always a more valuable use of his time. To see his legacy so inert would be the ultimate defeat. There's still hope, however, because for every 100 people who see a photograph of Che, there will be a few who become curious, a few who seek out his origins. And from those few, a select handful will become enamored with Che's life, his vitality and his strange morality and his fire. His drive to make the world a better place no matter the cost will inspire them to do the same. Che's son, Aida Guevara, told The Guardian that he didn't want people to use his father's face unthinkingly. He doesn't like to see him stitched on the backside of a pair of mass-produced jeans. "But look at the people who wear Che t-shirts," he said. "They tend to be those who don't conform, who want more from society, who are wondering if they can be better human beings. That, he thinks, he would have liked." I'm not quite sure that I can agree. While I can concede that the proliferation of Che's photo may have brought dividends to leftism, communism, and revolutionary pursuits back in the 60s and 70s, I feel that Che's image has been so spread out that it has lost a lot of its meaning. Not to mention, there was nothing Che hated more than capitalism. And now the capitalist monster has exploited him for the benefit of the bourgeoisie. I highly doubt he could reconcile that, no matter the small increase in influence. To conclude, there are some pros and cons to Che Guevara's image. The pros would be the infamy he gained from this proliferation of his image, along with spreading his ideas with his face. But the cons are really quite heavy. Capitalist gain was what Che hated more than anything in the world. And so for him to be part of that would really devastate him. There was also the entropy of impact, meaning that the more his face is spread, the less it actually matters. because people don't end up caring to learn what he truly was about. So I'm going to leave this decision up to you, but I do implore you to consider both these pros and cons before deciding whether or not Che Guevara would ultimately be proud of his legacy. Thank you.